In Philippa Langley's and Rob Rinder's recent documentary about the Princess in the Tower, an alleged self-witness account of Richard of York's escape from the tower was presented, which the team found in the Netherlands. The excitement was great, and this document is one of the reasons why the Ricardians are certain that Richard III did not kill the princess. On Langley's personal homepage, for example, you can see the picture of Perkin Warbeck with the name Richard of England. The current issue of the Ricardian Bulletin looks like this, so they are also celebrating victory here. But rightly so. Before we go into detail, let us first note a methodological problem in the documentary. For this, let's listen to a member of the archive team about the source in question.
It was in our archive of loose acquisitions, which is an archive of documents that don't really belong in a collection. So we don't know anything about its provenance. We don't know where it's from.
Unfortunately, provenance is not explained in the documentary. Put simply, it is everything we know about a historical source that is not the actual content of the source. This allows us to use the provenance as a guide to the authenticity and quality of the source, as the Oxford English Dictionary puts it. The provenance was very poor for all the sources presented. For the source from Dresden, I have already provided it in a video in more detail. In the case of Richard's witness report, however, there is at least the reference from the archive. So it is surprising that Langley then says the following.
We think that the original would have been written in Latin or French, but this is a copy in Middle Dutch.
This is provenance and requires an explanation, as the documentary has just previously shown the archive employee saying that the house knew nothing about it. It is possible that this explanation existed and was cut out, but this would be a mistake because of the contradiction that arises. The whole thing has the unpleasant aftertaste that those responsible for the documentary were hoping that viewers would not know what provenance means, and that Langley's statements would therefore not be questioned. But now to the content of the source and its plausibility, which we will check with the help of the tower. Let's listen to Langley again. I have edited the passages together.
I was brought to my brother, who was already there in the Tower of London.
Then what happens?
Then what happens is we were separated. I was secretly taken into a room in a place where the lions are kept. Lord Howard came to me and encouraged me. At last, he ordered the guards to leave and then brought two other men to me. They were called Henry Percy and Thomas Percy. They swore by honor and oath to hide me secretly until certain years were passed.
You've checked these guys?
I've checked out all of these guys.
And they were there at the time?
They were there.
They were in Richard's inner circle. They would have been close to the princess. It adds to the credibility and the reliability of the whole narrative.
Then they shaved my hair and put a poor and drab skirt on me. And we went to St. Catherine's. St. Catherine's is a dockyard.
Let's take a look at the map. The Bloody Tower is not mentioned by name, but we can probably assume that it is where the supposed Richard was united with his brother. The Lion's Tower is located to the far east of the site. St. Catherine's is on the west of the site. Those who do not know the positions will quickly tend to name St. Catherine's at this time still Kai and not Dock as the place of departure. It was a precinct around the hospital St. Catherine's by the tower, which was given some special rights, particularly in the 15th century. The Kai was one of the few ports of call where ships from abroad could legally dock and depart. At first glance, this departure point therefore seems logical. However, this results in the following route, which seems unnaturally long, especially as Richard was only disguised in the Lion's Tower by poor clothing and a shave. it seems to make more sense to take him directly away from the complex in the east or to have him board the ship on the wharf. The legality of docking was probably of secondary importance anyway due to the prominent passenger. If Richard III was behind this escape, the direct boarding on the wharf wouldn't have been a problem at all. If the protector and soon-to-be king, already king, wasn't behind it, the risk of walking completely past the tower with the boy seems enormous. Langley would probably reply that this was done with John Howard's and presumably Richard's knowledge. Nevertheless, every guard on the walls would have to have been privy to this. This seems very risky. This is supported by the fact that, according to the report, there were two guards at Lyne's Tower, but they were sent away by Howard. The Lyne's Tower location also seems questionable. I show some pictures of what it looks like today and what it looked like when it was not yet in ruins. Incidentally, the documentary also assumes that it is the Lyne's Tower. The animated passage proves that. The report describes how a 9-year-old boy was left alone, presumably at night, in a room with dangerous wild animals. At least lions were also present, according to the report that says the rooms where the lions were kept. And this, despite the fact that it was known that there were repeated accidents with the animals. The risk of the boy becoming frightened, starting to cry and or scream seems very high. This idea can also be found to some extent in the source, as John Howard is said to have encouraged Richard. It should be remembered that shortly before this, Richard learned of his father's death, was taken to the asylum of Westminster Abbey with his family, separated from them, including his mother, taken to his brother, and then separated from him too. Strange men were now escorting him. It seems very, very risky to pursue the plan in this way. Especially as guards were also involved. Howard had been Earl Marshal since June 28th, and as such was probably a big enough authority figure to send guards away. But he was not their commander. That role fell to Robert Brackenbury as Constable of the Tower. If the source is correct, he must have been in on it. This is supported by another fact. Brackenbury was master of the Mint after the execution of Hastings. He was therefore the person who supervised the activities of the Royal Mint and could ensure that the street was empty the day the source reports about. Inevitably, the question arises as to whether Hastings might have had to die because of this. To be able to give Brackenbury control of the Royal Mint. It is supported by the idea that Hastings could have refused to have coins minted with Richard's picture, because he wouldn't accept the protector as the new king. Whatever happened to the princess, Brackenbury played absolutely a key role. But back to the Lyne's Tower. We have 5 confidants secured by the source so far. Howard, Henry and Thomas Percy, and the 2 guards. Brackenbury is very likely to be one of them too. The possibility that other guards on the walls were in on it does not seem out of the question, given this less than ideal route. So, we are talking about a potentially very frightened child who remembers a lot of details, that had to spend time alone with lions, maybe in the darkness, lots of confidence and a bad escape route. None of this can be ruled out. However, it is absolutely legitimate to point out that it simply doesn't seem plausible. In addition, the document clearly names a Thomas Percy. However, I cannot identify him for the year 1483. Henry Percy does have a grandson called Thomas, which became very famous in the Anne Boleyn drama, but he was not born until 1504. There was also a Thomas Percy around 1400. He was the first Earl of Worcester. There was also a Thomas Percy who died in 1460. This was the first Baron Egremont. Langley confirms in the documentary that she knows that he was there at the time in question. It is entirely possible that she has a knowledge advantage, but she should then clarify who that is. My best guess is that it could be Thomas de Burgh, who was highly courted by Richard III and was a relative to the Percy family. But at the moment, the name is more evidence that the source is fake. One last thought about it. If you consider the source as real, there's the need to have a discussion about the oath the Percys gave to Richard. It sounds a lot like the oath to a king and not just keeping him safe. Why inserting the yes in there if it was just about keeping him secret and safe? The yes make it clear that the prince could come back someday. To support this, Henry Percy was one of the commanders of Richard III during the Battle of Bosworth. Here, he famously held his troops back from entering the fight. So, just for the sake of it, let's say it was an oath to recognize the boy as a king. That not only would mean that they didn't act on Richard III's commands, they felt the need to save the boy from him. So they thought he was in danger, and Edward V was still alive at this point. So why recognize the younger of them as king? Maybe because they knew that Edward had to die or died in this very night. I am sure a lot of you will say that this is really far-fetched, and maybe you are right about this, but it's at least worth talking about, because maybe Langley accidentally presented evidence that Richard III had one prince killed and wanted to kill the other one as well.